Good evening, everyone. I have the honor to shortly introduce tonight's lecturer, Silvia Federici, who is a feminist activist, writer, and teacher, one of the co-founders of the International Feminist Collective that launched an international campaign, Wages for Housework, in 1972. Since 1987 to 2005, she held courses in international and women's studies and political philosophy at Hofstra University in New York, where she became a professor emerita. Silvia Federici wrote numerous books and articles on philosophy, culture, education, feminist theory, and women's history, and recently her interests are also focused on researches and feminist reconstruction of commons and occupy movements. Her most influential book is The Cannibal and the Witch, Women and the Body and the Primitive Accumulation, whose translation into the Serbian is expected next year. Her second most influential book is Revolution at the Point Zero, Housework, Reproduction and Feminist Struggle, which is published in 2012 as a collection of articles written in period from 1975 till now. Tonight, she will talk about many subjects under the title Gender and Democracy in the Neoliberal Agenda, Feminist Politics, Past and Present. As feminism has been institutionalized and subsumed to the neoliberal agenda in the name of democratization, a feminist critique of liberal democracy is more urgent than ever. This is probably the one point that she talk about. And one more note, after the keynote lecture, as always at the Subversive Festival, you're all welcome to ask questions and pose some comments. So obviously we have a lot of things to do, maybe to give you the words. Silvia, the stage is all yours.
Thank you. I think I'm going to stay up, because I like to see everybody. Well, thank you, first of all, for having come this evening, and thank you to the organizers of this conference for having invited me here. I'm also very grateful that this conference on democracy has been organized, because we are now living in an historical moment when the question of democracy and the need to clarify what do we mean by this principle, by this concept, it's more than ever urgent. On one side, as you all know, as we heard last night, democracy, the democratic system, has never been at the lowest level. Although we have to recognize that for large parts of the world population, democracy has never existed, even in the limited liberal sense of bourgeois democracy. At the same time, we have seen a resurgence of movements. You know, we're trying to experiment with new forms of democracy. We're variously defined. People speak of radical democracy, and I believe the Chantal Mouffe will probably speak in that direction, or real democracy. There is also a very strong reluctance to give up this concept, because there is a realization that, you know, whatever liberties we have enjoyed, limited as they have been the product of a tremendous struggle. In other words, capitalism has never been democratic. And I think historically you can see it took two centuries of struggle for workers in Europe to even gain the right to refuse work or to move from job to job. And the period of the Enlightenment, which has been supposed to be the period which has seen the flourishing, the blossoming of bourgeois democracy, was in fact a time in which enslavement and the famous plantation system actually peaked. So it's very important that we understand that when we speak of democracy, we speak of something that has been really, in many ways, the product of a lot of struggle. And this is why there is, again, a reluctance to give up this concept and credit the capitalist system with producing even limited liberties, which in reality cost rivers of blood. So it is in this very spirit of redefinition and reclamation that I want to speak of the contribution that the women's movement has made to democracy. And I want to stress that my main references are to the women's movement in the United States, because this is the movement that I'm most familiar with, and it's also the movement in which I've been active for many years. But obviously, my comments and my point of reference are not only women's struggle in the US, but certainly, you know, women's struggle and grassroots feminist movement in many other parts of the world, and particularly in Latin America as well as Europe. Now, it seems to me that feminism and women's struggles in general have made a very, very important contribution to democracy in that they have extended the struggle, the challenge against power inequalities way beyond the formal sphere of the sphere of formal political relations. And they've extended the process of democratization to many, many areas of our life, generally not conceived as political. And I would say that this process that has culminated in the 1970s, it's a process that has a long history. In other words, feminist movement, even before the 1970s, have never been exclusively concerned with the question of obtaining democratic rights or the question of achieving the right to vote. Even the suffrage movement of the 19th century was always concerned with the question of marriage, with the question of power relation between women and men. And it's only in the first part of the 19th century, after World War I, that the struggle for the vote became very crucial. Now, by the time I came of age, by the time feminism blossomed in the 70s, it was very clear, however, that the vote was a very blunted instrument, that in fact, the extension of the vote to women, the entrance of women into electoral politics, which was pretty much completed by the end of World War II, did not produce the kind of transformation of women's life and also social and political life that it had been promised. So, not surprisingly, the women's movement of the 1970s was very much unconcerned with obtaining, you know, recognition within the sphere of democratic rights. And instead, its main contribution to democratization consisted in the fact that it did revolutionize the concept of what is the political. If there is one outstanding contribution that the feminist movement and women's struggle have made, certainly since the 70s, has been this question of redefining what we mean by the political and refusing to equate the political, you know, with the sphere of government, with the sphere of the law, and insisting instead that what we call the political extend way beyond that, into our family, into the home, into sexual relationship between women and men. And in fact, the concept of the personal is the political encapsulate this redefinition. Also, I want to quote here a slogan that has become very popular that women in Chile coined in the 1970s and 80s, which is democracy in the home, democracy in the country. To say that in fact you cannot separate the democratization of family relationship, reproductive relationship, from the democratization of political power in general. But what does it mean the personal is the political? Let's look at it a bit more in close by. And I want to say that by recognizing that political power is exercised in many sides, not only in the sphere of formal politics, but is exercised in the sphere of so-called personal relationship, you know, in the so-called sphere of private relationship. I would say that the women's movement has lifted the veil on one of the best kept secrets of capitalist society, which is the fact that capitalism has in fact subsumed the whole area of so-called personal relationship and has subsumed to the process of production, to the accumulation of capital, because it has transformed that sphere of activity and relation into a sort of social factory in which labor power is produced, in which the workforce is continuously produced and reproduced. And in that sense, the political character of family relationship, the political character of the home, it's rooted precisely in the fact of its function in the capitalist organization of work. And feminists have also been able to see that the separation of the public from the public, the public from the private, and the personal from the political, has been very instrumental to hiding a whole immense sphere of unpaid labor, precisely the labor that in capitalism women have done, you know, in the process of reproducing the workforce. And therefore that this separation has actually been an artificial capitalist construction that has served again to hide an immense terrain of exploitation, also to hide the fact that capitalism has basically delegated to man, the wage worker, you know, the power to control in the home and command women's labor as well as women's body, as women's body too are crucial to the production of capital, to the production of the workforce. Now, certainly in taking this step, I think that the women's movement has potentially taken an initiative, begun a process of rethinking what are the material foundation of a democratic society. Because in lifting the veil on this terrain of exploitation, they've also realized another secret of capitalism, which is the fact that capitalism, in a sense, needs structurally to devalue reproductive work. Because by devaluing reproductive work, by treating reproductive work, which has historically been the work of women, at least in capitalism, by doing that, it has in fact devalued labor power. It has in fact contained, cheapened the cost of labor. And this has been a structural need, and in fact it's not a surprise that throughout the history of capitalism we see an eternal return of moments in which we have massive devaluation of people's labor power. Now, in my view, unfortunately, the women's movement was not capable to find a strategy that would enable them to concretize, to transform this insight you know, into a revolutionary policy, into a transformative policy. Many of us, myself included, at that time in the 70s fought for wages for housework. In fact, I was part of an international campaign for wages for housework because we believed that by demanding wages for this work, which has been historically unpaid, we were, in fact, beginning to expose this work, show that, in fact, this activity that is always being seen as a work of love is, in fact, real work, that it's not a legacy of the past, but, in fact, it is a capitalist construction, and therefore, that in a way, by challenging this unpaid labor, we would also challenge the capitalist organization of work. And we thought that by demanding wages for household, by organizing around wages for household, we would also operate, create the condition for the recomposition among women. Because in one way or the other, according to our view, all women have been, in fact, defined as housewives. All women have been affected by this identity, by this labor. Now, the women's movement did not take this path. In fact, the women's movement saw as a strategy, adopted as a strategy, the entrance into wage labor as a form of emancipation. I don't have the time now today to elaborate, to present a full critique of this strategy, but I would argue that this strategic mistake, in a way, I'm not saying that it's a mistake to take a job for a wage, absolutely not, but the strategizing it. Strategizing it meant that the terrain of reproduction was practically abandoned. That much of the energies, initiatives, struggle that women built, at least in the US and also many parts of Europe, was concentrated on obtaining better condition in the workforce, obtaining parity with men in what was considered the workforce. And in that sense, the home, the community, reproduction were abandoned in the United States in such a way that we were not even able to win maternity leave. Nevertheless, there were important changes were produced by the women's movement on the condition of reproductive work. And these changes, in my view, represent an important steps in the direction of a democratization of everyday life. For example, the women's movement established the principle that women have a control over their own body. It's not the state, it's not men who have to decide about women's body, but it's women themselves. Unfortunately, that principle was translated in the struggle for abortion, which is a very limited struggle. It's a very limited perspective and one, in fact, counterproductive. To the extent that hand in hand with the denial of abortion, you know, we had practices by the state attempting to sterilize, you know, women, when particularly poor women, low-income women, and women of color. Again, another important step was the struggle to establish that wife beating, battering, it's a crime. Whereas it has traditionally been seen literally almost as a condition of housework. Traditionally, violence against women in the family, beginning with battering, is not being considered a crime. In the same way as today as well, violence against children is not seen as something that should be forbidden, unless you really cause them incredible damage. Violence against children is supposed to be a parental right. Similarly, used to be that when a husband beat up his wife, and even when she went bleeding to the hospital, you know, the hospital workers or the police, if the police got involved, said, okay, why don't you take a walk around the house, blow it out, and, you know, make peace. Similarly, for example, the struggle, the women made a struggle to establish that there is such a thing as rape in the family. In other words, that the fact that you marry does not mean that you forfeit the right over your body and that your husband has a right to, you know, sexual encounter at will. These may appear as small steps, but I think actually have been important and in the direction of a democratization of everyday life. And I would say that, you know, even sexual relationship have been democratized. Even the bedroom has been democratized. There have been important changes, for example, in the way sexual relationship have been have taken place, because women have insisted on the right to be able to have something more than work in their sexual encounters with men or with other partners. Now, most important, you know, women have challenged the inequality that are rooted in the division of labor, in the sexual division of labor. And again, these steps have been extremely important and have not been, however, the only contribution the feminist movement have made to democratization. I want to mention very briefly the rise of ecofeminism in the 1980s. Ecofeminism has received very much bad publicity because it is often claimed that ecofeminists have, in fact, promoted an idea of relationship between women and nature. And I think perhaps some have, but I want to mention something important about ecofeminism, which is that they have shown that the capitalist destruction, the destruction of the environment, is also a structural element of capitalism. That in the same way as capitalism has been parasitic on the unpaid labor of women, as well as the unpaid labor of many plantation workers, in the same way it has also been parasitic on the environment, in that it has freely appropriated an immense amount of resources which are part of our commonwealth and in fact have been taken, destroyed, contaminated. And the fact that the contamination, destruction of the environment is an attack on our democratic rights, is an attack on democracy, because it undermines our capacity for self-determination. It undermines our capacity to sustain ourselves on this earth. This, I think, has been an important contribution of ecofeminist movement. In the early phase of the women's liberation movement, there was also a whole challenge and mobilization against militarism. You know, in the early 1980s, when the Reagan administration relaunched its warmongering, and particularly they raised the spectrum again of nuclear warfare, when Reagan decided to deploy perishing and cruise missiles in many parts of Europe, we saw across the US and Europe a powerful anti-militarist, anti-nuclear women's movement that created many camps, peace camps, that inspired, were an inspiration to basically the struggle against war. Now, last but still too quickly perhaps, the feminist movement also democratized political practice by insisting on creating non-hierarchical form of political organizing, decentralized, not hierarchical forms, and also, which I think is extremely important, in not separating the political moment, political activism, from the transformation of everyday life. I think out of their own experience, you know, women learn that if you want to do political work, you have to change your life. And this, I think, it's a lesson that has had a strong influence that is still felt today in the new movement, for example, the Occupy movement. Why you have to transform your everyday life? Well, in the case of women, it was very clear. In many cases, if you wanted to make a struggle against capitalism, you first had to fight against the man in the family to be able to go out in the evening, to go to a meeting. In order to be able to take many initiatives, you first had to confront yourself, you know, with the type of policing, the type of surveilling that, in fact, has been taking place in the family. Now, because of the potentially very subversive character of the feminist movement, for all the reasons that I have enunciated, and it's not surprising that by the late 70s, mid late 70s, we have witnessed a massive intervention, institutional intervention into feminist politics, very much aimed at domesticating the women's movement, and not only domesticating it, but neutralizing its subversive potential, but also channel the women's movement into the support for the neoliberal agenda. Basically make it into a force that would actually give support to the developing neoliberal agenda. Yes? Okay. What am I referring to? You know, let me actually sidetrack for a minute. I think that there is an important comparison here. There is an important parallel between what has happened in the late 70s, starting in the late 70s through the 80s and until recently, in the relationship between the United Nations and the feminist movement. There is a comparison with the role that the United Nations played with regard to the anti-colonial movements. At the moment in which it became clear that the anti-colonial struggle could not be defeated, could not be annulled, the United Nations came into the foreground and appointed itself as the decolonizer, as the decolonizing agency, of course, in a very selective way. But in a way that would guarantee that decolonization would take place in ways compatible with the needs and the program of international capitalism. Well, something very similar has happened in the 80s and 90s, you know, with regard to the feminist movement. Starting with the conference in Mexico City in 1975, and then 1980, Copenhagen, Nairobi, 85, Beijing, the organization of global conferences on women, the launching of the Decade of Women, 1975-85, and through this initiative, the creation of a whole cadre of global feminists, what I call global feminists, you know, or are the women, in a sense, appointed to represent the women of the world, represent the women of the world, function as a sort of union, you know, as a sort of spokeswomen for which who have played an important role in redefining what has been, what should be the feminist agenda, and redefining it in a way very compatible, you know, with the neoliberal program. Which, in fact, basically was motivated by the need to integrate women into all kinds of development projects and destroy all kinds of forms of subsistence economy, integrate women in the monetary system and into a labor market, you know, more and more deregulated and in fact characterized by, you know, form of almost coerced labor. And, you know, in fact, we have seen what empowerment for women has meant. Empowerment for women has meant, in fact, introduction in free export zone. You know, I don't know if you've heard, by the way, the latest atrocity in Bangladesh last week, 750 people, mostly young women, right, killed because of the collapse of one of these factories. And this is one more accident after many, many others in which women have been burnt alive because this free export zone, which are one of the sites of female empowerment in the eyes of the United Nations, in this free export zone, women are practically jailed, you know, working, you know, from dawn to dusk, and you know, for the pittance, in condition they very often ruin their lives, ruin their bodies, and this is very emblematic of the type of ways in which women have been integrated into the democracy, into the democratic system. It's not an accident that the decade for women and the years of most intense activism by the United Nations on behalf of women's rights have also been the time period in which the condition of people across the world and the condition of women in particular have deteriorated most dramatically. And they have deteriorated because of policies inaugurated, introduced, imposed by sister agencies, by agencies connected with the United Nations, like the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, World Trade Organization, and so forth. Right. Now, what is the alternative to this situation? What is the alternative to this situation? Clearly, what we are seeing and what I'm talking to tonight is the fact that we are encountering two very different opposite concepts of democratization and very different opposite concepts, obviously, of feminism. Whereas on one side, we're speaking of a feminism and a concept of democratization that is based on the idea of a revalorization of the process of reproduction, you know, as the beginning step for the creation of society where the value of human life, the value of human being, is above the value of commodities. On the other hand, we are seeing a process of democratization, where democratization means the removal of any protective regulation, placing a limit on the most savage exploitation on human life, and placing a limit to the continuous destruction of people's means of subsistence, because the destruction is functional to turn them into labor power available for the most intense form of exploitation. And of course, when you destroy the means of reproduction, you know, you have also to attack women, first of all, because women have been, are the main subject of reproductive work. Today, the consequences of UN-made feminism are very clear to us. The women's movement has been, to a large extent, neutralized, has lost to a great extent its autonomy. Feminism still exists, but not as a massive force, not as a transformative force in the way it was in the early 70s. By the way, another small digression, which I think is important, to say that the collapse of socialism has also played a role in the determination, in the definition of the kind of policies that we have seen implemented by World Bank, IMF, and so forth. Because in the moment in which no competitive alternative existed, right, with the demise of the socialist state, in a sense, capitalism, you know, dropped any pretense of social justice. I mean, this is something that maybe we can discuss in the question period. In any case, today, What we are witnessing, it's a situation in which a feminist movement, a new feminist initiative, and by feminist I mean women and men as well, it's more than ever needed. It is more than ever needed because we are experiencing, as you know, an immense reproductive crisis that it's most dramatic in certain parts of the world, but has not spared any part of the world. If I can speak for the United States, women in the United States now, many of them, a large majority, have a job outside the home, and their life is a life of continuous crisis. It's a life of continuous crisis because it's work, work, work. And by the way, there's no precarity about reproductive labor. We keep hearing about precarity, precarity, precarity. This is true. Wage labor is being precarized. But let's remember that unpaid reproductive work, domestic work, is not precarious. It's always there. Sunday as well as Monday. Christmas as well as non-vacation days. So, and that work has not diminished because of the fact that women have in fact entered en masse the wage labor force. So that now women are doing two jobs, even three jobs, no time for themselves, very little money, and I'm speaking predominantly, not women in general, but I'm speaking, of course, predominantly of working class women. And, the picture of their life, the picture, the consequences for their life is very graphically demonstrated by the illnesses that characterize most women today, and the fact that women are the biggest consumer of antidepressant. Millions and millions of pills, in fact, today are being consumed by women and are helping them to push the week, to go yet another day in a situation in which crisis is permanent. Every day is a permanent crisis. So what is the solution? Well, 30 years ago, maybe the solution, in fact, 30 years ago, I was thinking of the solution to the question of unpaid labor, to the question of sexual hierarchies and relationship between women and men, through the struggle for wages for housework. Right? Again, seen not as an end point, but seen as an instrument to change power relations, as an instrument to expose, domestic labor as work, and begin to initiate that whole process that would expose the true functioning of a capitalist organization of work. Today, that program is not enough. And in fact, more and more, myself and I'm part of the large area of people who in fact is now thinking more and more that one of the most urgent things that we need to do is the construction of new forms of social cooperation. We can use the word the common or commons to describe that project, but certainly the idea of beginning, starting from our reproduction to reorganize ourselves in a more cooperative, collective way is becoming more and more evident as an important first step, as a priority, in fact, for any other type of struggle. Why this is the case? Why the commons? What we mean by that? One of the first things that we mean by that, and the reason why we think it's a priority, is precisely the crisis of reproduction that we are facing. We are living in a situation in which now, every day, one more social service is being cut. And not only one more social service is being cut, whether it is childcare, care for the elderly, hospital care, value, but now the capitalist class has the power to tell us that, you know, you are on your own. You know, we are witnessing what we call a financialization of our reproduction. Financialization means that we have to continuously pay for reproducing ourselves. And not surprisingly, in fact, most people are now collapsing under a huge wave of debt. Because continuously, from education to healthcare to public transport to subsidies to basic commodities, everything is destroyed. So we need to create cooperative forms of reproduction, first of all, in terms of our poor survival. But most of us think of the commons not just as forms as means of survival, but rather as form initiatives that can constitute the embryo of a new type of society, the embryo of a new type of social relation, in that the idea behind the common is that we regain control. We begin the process of regaining control over our reproduction and also reorganize it in a more cooperative, collective way. This is very important for many, many reasons. One is that we need to reconstitute the social fabric and the social organization in our community, in our neighborhood, that has been destroyed by the economic restructuring. You know, right now we use the word community, but we have no community. Community doesn't exist. You know, recently when you know, many people from the movement, from the Occupy movement, after an hurricane, they went to these very poor areas of New York, which the city of New York had totally abandoned. And they began to come. They came and they brought, you know, first aid and so on. They realized that these people who were very poor, it was one of the poor community, many of them had not talked to their neighbor. You know, it was the first time they were talking to their neighbors, right? This is what we mean by the fact that the communities have been so fragmented, so the forms of organization that exist in working class organization that existed in the past do not exist any longer. We need to recreate those fabrics. And also we need them to recreate them also as a form of defense and as a form and as a base from which to begin to challenge the state and begin the process of reclamation of our means of reproduction. Because obviously we cannot create cooperative forms of reproduction, we cannot regain control of our life, we cannot begin a new society if we also do not begin to reappropriate the wealth that we have produced, which is now is in the hands of the state. But in order even to build that kind of struggle, you know, I mean, in order in fact to create a cooperative society, we also need to construct the power to do it. Last night, Susan George faulted the Occupy movement for not wanting demands. There's a whole discussion about demands, but one of the reasons is that also, right now, we can have the most beautiful demands of the state, but we don't have the power to back them up. So the fact that we need, in fact, to begin to cooperate in a different way, and we need to recreate those forms of organization or new forms of organization because the older ones have been destroyed, is extremely urgent, is extremely important. Now, again, in this way, we think also that the commons can be both an objective as well as a condition of our struggle. We think of them now as a sort of transitional form that is not completely alternative to the public, but certainly is interested in creating the foundation of a new system of production, of a new system of reproduction as well. And I'm very encouraged by the fact that among the new generation, there is an interest in this type of project. I think that for all its limitation and for all its problems, the Occupy movement has developed not only in Wall Street, but has developed in many, many parts of the world. In the United States, it has developed in 600 cities. It's been an important manifestation of this need and this realization. Realization that, in a way, was at the core of the feminist movement's conception of politics, which is we have to start from reproduction. We have to start from the transformation of our everyday life. And we have to reorganize that life also in a new way, in a new cooperative way, both to gain more strength towards the state, right, and begin a process of democratization by repossession, democratization by repossession of what is. Maybe you can, yeah, okay, I think we have it again. And at the same time, to basically, yes, I mentioned that I wanted to speak about the Occupy movement, that the Occupy movement has realized the power of this collective, the reorganization of reproduction in a collective way. In fact, many, many young people were transformed by the fact of leaving this great experiment together for a number of months. You know, not only sleeping together, talking together, but also organizing food, organizing cleaning teams, you know, organizing space. And, you know, this need that I think many are feeling about a type of politic that does not separate everyday life from the political moment, I think is one of the most encouraging and powerful experiences today. Thank you very much.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much for the lecture. It raised lots of questions and theses, and I'm giving the opportunity for the audience to ask questions, please. Yes, please.
Well, I have to, since there's no other hand up, I will volunteer. And I have a very short question. I even apologize for it because it's very late and it's a theoretical one. But for me, it's not very clear. I was trying to understand your point about revolutionizing this reproductive sphere and the reproductive elements. But at the same time, you make this point very clear that everything is subordinated to a particular mode of production, which is capitalism, though you somehow shift from capitalism to the state at different times. But my question is, having this construction in place, the focus on reproduction becomes completely irrelevant in a sense. Because basically, if what determines the problems in the sphere of reproduction is this particular mode of production, the only way to actually change things is to address it and actually change it, smash capitalism. So I don't see, I mean, I'm actually trying to pose this question, how do you reconcile the two spheres together?
I'm not sure I understand the question, actually, because I think what I've been trying to say, I have an anti-capitalist politics. My feminism is anti-capitalist feminism. I don't think the capitalism is a system that it's not, I wouldn't even say sustainable, but it's acceptable. I think that capitalism has had 500 years to prove itself, and it has shown there is an eternal return War, misery, impoverishment, and now we have permanent primitive accumulation, permanent dispossession, permanent devaluation of our lives. So, as far as I'm concerned, whatever kind of struggle we engage in, it has to have an anti-capitalist horizon, beginning with feminist struggle. Now, how do we do it? How do we fight against capitalism? What I've been trying to say, and I'm not sure that it came out clearly, because sometimes, you know, you try to put too many things in a talk. But what I've been trying to say is that the women's movement, in addressing the question of inequalities, you know, power relation, an equal power relation between women and men, and the particular deficit of social power they have experienced in a capitalist society, you know, have unmasked, have brought to the surface one of the mechanisms, of the engines that has allowed capitalism to reproduce itself, right? And this engine has to do very much with the organization of the relation between production and reproduction. The fact that the reproduction of the workforce has been completely made invisible as work, that it has made invisible as exploitation, right? That capitalism has been able, through the wage, to mobilize the work of the unwaged, so that the wage worker has actually become the delegate, has been delegated the power to command the unwaged wife, the unwaged woman. That has been a very powerful mechanism to actually allow capitalism to perpetuate itself. That capitalism in this way has been able to accumulate an immense quantity of unpaid labor far beyond what the forefathers of socialism and Marxism imagined, right? And has been able also, right, to divide the working class, to create hierarchies, to create division, right, which has to do something with the class struggle, because if we're talking about the class struggle, proletariat unite and fight. No, proletarian do not unite and fight, because first, there's all kinds of division within the proletariat itself. Division that have to do with race, division that have to do with sex, and these divisions are structural. And this division, in what I've tried to say, is that, for example, sexism is a structural necessity of capitalist society, because sexism is the ideological justification for the fact that women have to be subordinated to men, and they are subordinated to men precisely because in that way, the whole sphere of labor appears as a personal act, appears as love. In fact, one of my first pamphlets that I wrote in begins with this statement, they call it love, we call it unpaid labor. And I think, yeah, there is love, but I think we'll experience it when we are free, when we'll be able not to have to sell our bodies in order to get a meal or something similar. Okay. So this is what I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say that the issue of reproduction is fundamental, because the issue of reproduction, the devaluation of reproduction, and the whole machine that capitalism has organized around reproduction has been central, has been a central mechanism for the accumulation of capital. Does it make sense?
Production, because it's still subordinated. I hear you and I totally agree, but if you want to make a change, the changes will not happen in the reproductive sphere, but still in the mode of production, because you say it yourself, you wouldn't have sexism.
But that differentiation that you are making, it's a capitalist differentiation.
No, but you made it yourself when you said waged labor.
But what
because you said it's the essence of capitalism.
Just not to be the ping pong, please. Okay. Yes. Any other questions from the audience, please? Yes. First, not Tony, but the...
Hi, Silvia. I just wonder whether you came across any theoretical models, they don't have to be economic, but simply even conceptual, which something like Ironmonger, which he did in Sydney, and he does it for last 20 years, but something that from your angle attributes production. I mean, what you're trying to explain to the person here, that the labor is labor in totality, if you want. So reproduction and wage labor is one lump of labor that happens in order for humans to reproduce. The thing is that capitalism and so the socialism that we had it here attributes only one part to be valuable and assigns monetary aspect to it, yes. So have you came across any conceptual frameworks or maybe economic frameworks which do look at the reproduction in totality?
But I think that for all the most many pre-capitalist society did not separate between production and reproduction. The moment in which you have production for consumption, not for the market. And here again, there is a whole story about the market because I want to, right? But the moment you do not separate, you know, commodity, something that is produced for the market, and the kind of separation you have in capitalism, then you do have that continuity. And I think in many pre-capitalist society, you had that continuity. Now, of course, I'm not proposing that we go back to the past, right? We have to invent new forms. But I also want to say that when people speak of the market, right? Today there was the issue of the market came out in many times. And I want to say that, we have to be very careful when we use that term, because there were markets long, long time ago. markets, people have exchanged things in different forms, right? When we speak of market, we speak of capitalist market. So it's not that, in a non-capitalist society, there will be no exchange. The question is the form of the exchange that is extremely important. I think we have to construct it, like the commons, are not a given. They are the product of our struggle. That's very important. They are not given. Even though we say that we have commons all around us, the air is still a common. But nevertheless, commons have to be produced.
Yes. There was a hand.
I just have one question. I was very intrigued by what I read in the announcement to the lecture, that the first accumulation of capital started in part with the help of witch hunt. So if you could just comment a few things, because you didn't mention it in the lecture. Yeah, thank you.
There was no space. Coming from my activism in the campaign for wages for housework and with the kind of framework that I have mapped, that I have outlined, just now, I engaged into a whole historical process. Because I wanted to understand, how, when did it begin? What happened with women in capitalism? At first I was very interested in the question of women in capitalism, but also I was very interested in understanding how the production of workers, how the reproduction process has changed in capitalist society, which Marx doesn't talk about, right? The whole horizon of his analysis of primitive accumulation is about the wage workers,
the formation of the wage worker. So I began to go back and back and back. Eventually I went back to the Middle Ages and the crisis of the feudal order, and then the beginning of capitalist society. And the beginning of capitalist society, what I met was this incredible historical phenomenon, which has been the 2-3 century of witch hunting. And it was very clear to me from the very beginning that this phenomenon was had nothing to do with feudal superstition, which had been, you know, the kind of analysis that for a long time prevailed, but was in fact a phenomenon that could only be explained with the development, the processes that were laying the condition of capitalist development. So that's the kind of analysis they began, you know, what did represent the witch hunt, and began to look at, for example, who were the witches, who were these women, you know, socially, sociologically, what kind of crimes they were accused of, and what were the forms of the persecution, in what areas they took place. So a whole set of things became clear that were very, very important. First of all, the chronology, the chronological coincidence between the Great Witch Hunts and the beginning of the slave trade, and also the process of the enclosures, you know, the expulsion of the European peasantry from the land, also the process of colonization, conquest and colonization of the parts of the Americas. So it was very clear that the witch hunt was online with these developments that have been historically recognized as foundational for the capitalist development. And in my assessment, you know, the analysis I developed in Caliban and the Witch is that, you know, there's a number of contexts that in fact begin to explain the witch hunt. And one certainly is the question of land enclosure, right? The enclosure of land was, particularly in Europe, was especially negative with its consequences for women, and particularly for older women, because the enclosure, again, not only destroyed, you know, many means of reproduction, but also disintegrated a certain type of community where older people had been cared for, where older people had been, in fact, capable of reproducing themselves. And so often the witches were women who were beggars, and they would beg, survive begging, you know, particularly among the better off. And if they were not satisfied, they would curse. They would curse the richer neighbors, and then they'll be accused of being witches. So this is one type of crime. And also, they were accused, many witches were accused of theft by magic arts. And obviously, this is the attack on property. Also, many witches were accused of sexual crime and reproductive crime, abortion, contraception. And these also are part, you know, are explainable on the basis of a new legislation that comes into place in the 16th and 17th century, you know, that begins to impose new restrictions on reproduction, on procreation, because there's a new conception of procreation that begins to attach procreation, you know, to the production of laborers, actually to the production of poor people, which is in fact the name of the worker in the first phase of capitalist development. So these are some, and by the way, I want to add very importantly that today we are witnessing a return of witch hunting. In fact, thousands and thousands of women starting in the 80s and 90s to this day have been burned alive or hanged or macheted in many parts of the world, in many African countries. In the north of Ghana, there are witches' camps. There are witches' camps in which thousands of women have been expelled from their villages, take refuge. In India, particularly in the tribal area, they are now witnessing massive, massive process of land expropriation. Part of Nepal. More recently, I don't know if you've seen it in your newspapers, 3 weeks ago, there was this horrifying pictures from Papua New Guinea, where there's been a massive attack on women. There was a picture of a woman who was being burnt alive. And again,
I don't want to take too much time, but again, you can show that there's a relationship between these new witch hunts, you know, and the process of globalization, that there's a connection between the kind of expropriation and restructuring of social relations that are taking place and the attack on women.
Thank you. Ivana.
Thank you for your really inspiring talk. My name is Ivana. I am wondering about how to make this change. How do we create the community where we don't separate the everyday life and the politics? Are we, in your opinion, how ready are we? And if we are not, how to do it in a way that wouldn't be violent, that we don't prescribe, that minority doesn't prescribe a new order, because I don't think that's gonna help. And yeah, so how do we shift the consciousness? What is, in your opinion, a view, a perspective on how do we get to a different point?
Is this working? Yeah, it's a very interesting. I mean, that's, you know, it very much depends on the context, depends on everything. I want to say our experience, for example, in New York, some of the first steps years ago was beginning to discuss the forms of politics, of doing politics, you know, because many of us have been involved in the anti-globalization movement, not only the feminist movement, but the anti-globalization movement. And, you know, there was, of course, a great enthusiasm in, you know, the late 80s, Seattle, and so forth. And then with this experience of this great moment of surging, you know, the great, we get together in this big demonstration, Praga, and Seattle, and so on, and then goes down, and the movement seems to dissipate. And this sense of frustration, this sense of discontinuity sparked off a kind of debate, you know, how do we develop the concept of a self-reproducing movement, you know, how do we create a self-reproducing movement, you know, a movement that does not continuously surge and collapse, you know. For instance, It's a real problem because there's also an issue of continuity, transmission of knowledge, right? So that we don't always start from zero. For example, we recognize now that the old parties of the left, the communist parties and so on, for all their many, many problems, they had a function. They did transmit some knowledge. They actually represented, you know, provided a sort of generational continuity so that people learned about the struggles the others had done. So we began to see, and more we fell back, you know, into many of the tactics and the perspective of the feminist movement, which is, well, we begin from our everyday life. We begin from the fact that we organize politically in a way where we do not separate, right, the political moment from our everyday life. And I would say that this is a very important step that can then, you know, expand to, you know, in a broader way. For instance, we had very, very interesting discussion and also a production of literature on this matter. You know, we had people who said, yeah, I feel the movement is leaving me behind. I have children, you know. The movement is really, if only for young people, it's for people who are in perfect health, it's for people who have a certain amount of time and availability, because the forms of organizations are such, right, that do not allow me to be part of it. Right, so this is one concern. How do we organize? What kind of form? And to what extent actually being in a political movement is putting our life in common? To what extent we are really putting our life in common? And so that, for example, when we go to a demonstration, etc., we know who is with us. We know the person next to us, which was the power the many working class community had. When working class community enter a strike, many cases knew whether the people around them in the community were ready to go to the end or were not. You know, there was a knowledge of each other and forms of commitment, often forms of division, of course, but there were forms of commitment that represented an important strength. Right? Our life has become much more disconnected, you know, so that particularly in a large urban center, we meet for political gathering, we meet for the demonstration, but it's become very difficult. So this is a beginning process.
More questions? Yes.
So I think that one of the very important aspects of what you gave in the book, Caliban and the Witch, is also the thing that besides slavery and witch hunt, there is this institutionalizing of prostitution. And I think that is also very much something that the European society is complying to. Like also, I don't know, we don't see, supposedly we don't see burning women in Bangladesh, but we certainly see bordels on the border between Austria and Czech Republic. So, I mean, this is, I think, one of the very important struggle within the European continent, you know, complying to the institutionalized prostitution. And that compliance is very widespread, I think.
I think, again, there is a continuity here between what has been happening in the 1980s with the globalization process and, in a way, the early phase, you know, the period that saw the development of capitalist relation. If you have, those of you who have read Caliban and the Witch, you know that I speak of the massification of prostitution. You know, one of the main first consequences of land expropriation was certainly the massification of prostitution at the very moment when prostitution that had been actually accepted socially throughout the Middle Ages, you know, became criminalized. And nevertheless, of course, this was one of the avenues that women resorted to with the end of basically the access to the commons. We see the same processes today. In fact, there's been a massification of prostitution as sex work across the world. You know, I think to some extent, but I think to a rather limited extent, that increase in the number of women who are turning to sex work has also had to do with the fact that the feminist movement, right, has given a contribution to undermining the kind of moral stigma attached to sex work. You know, I think the women's movement has also given power, you know, to, for example, prostitutes to present themselves as sex workers. It's not an accident that on the wake of the feminist movement, you have the beginning of a sex workers movement throughout Europe, for instance. So that stigma, you know, feminists have really attacked the hypocrisy, right, of that division of women, you know, the good women, the mother, the holy mother, whole self-sacrificial, and, you know, and the prostitute, which is the woman who does sexual work, but for money, right? And she gets paid, and so in fact that she is in violation of the first rule that you work for nothing. And so you have that separation of the bad woman and the good woman, and the women's movement has really challenged that separation and in that way given power to sex workers to move. So part of the increase in the number of sex workers, today there are many women, students, also housewife, I know in the United States, who do sex work on the side to complement, you know, sometimes forms of wage labor which don't pay enough, or to pay your tuition, you do some sex work on the side. I know many, many cases of women who do that, particularly now that you can also do sex work electronically, right? You can actually do it from your bedroom. You know, interactive sex, for instance. I don't know if you have this form of sex work by phone, sex by phone, interactive sex, These are all ways in which you can actually integrate sex work practically in your routine as you're cooking your food and, you know. But much of the increase in the number of sex workers have had to do also with the conditions of living, with the fact that, you know, for women, in the end, in many cases, sex work pays better than working as a maid. In fact, many women, I've done work, research work, on immigrant women, women who migrate to get a job, for instance, as maid, as healthcare workers. And in many cases, after 1 or 2 years of working as a maid, if they can, they may opt to do sex work because what they may earn, you know, in a much shorter time is much more. But of course, as part of sex work, we also have the all forms of coercion, you know, immense amount of brutality. The sex business is one of the most violent business, but it's not the only violent business. If you work in a free export zone, your life is as much in danger as if you work in a, you know, in a brothel or on the street. I think there's a major problem with the feminist movement. There's been a major, major problem that the feminist movement has been very split on the question of sex work. And I don't know how it is here in Croatia and how it is in the Balkans, but I know that I've had many, many discussions, I mean, you know, with feminist friends, and often they are on the opposite side, because I have some friends and some feminists who do not want to hear about sex work. They think that to even speak of sex work is to validate a kind of activity that is contrary to women's rights, is contrary to the basically transformative image of women, right? And on the other hand, you know, there are in fact many other feminists who see sex work as a legitimate type of work among the options that are available to women. And I place myself in that second group. I think that to particularly criticize, you know, women who opt for sex labor is very short-sighted, because it really stems from a sort of moralistic position, given that you know, the many, many other forms of work today have very exposed women, you know, to the same dangerous situation, and perhaps in some cases even more, and expose women to situation that basically put them in a completely subordinate position, and it's a position that makes them vulnerable to violence. So, okay, I'll leave it at that. And I'd like to hear maybe some comments coming from you on this question.
Comments, please. Don't be afraid of the sex topic. Yes. Yeah. Stanimir.
I don't wanna explicitly relate to the sex question and debate in feminism, but what I wanna say as a kind of comment, it's not really a question, has to do with you know, the divided character of femininity, which you mentioned, you know, the mother, the Madonna whore, let's call it, dyad, you know, it's going to be much more explicit. You know, my question relates to the following, you know, this is a much older division of the character of femininity. It goes back to, you know, ancient Greece, basically, you know, and I'm very curious to know, where do you stand in this? It's a very perpetual debate. I don't think it's going to ever stop. But where do you stand in this debate on the trans ideological character of sexism. And I'm asking this, I mean, is patriarchy constitutive of or inherent only to capitalism? This is very much the question. Because, you know, ancient Greece, you know, the sort of specimen of democracy from a Eurocentric perspective, the ancient demos, you know, has been, you know, sexist to begin with. You know, women were domesticated from scratch, you know. And, you know, from this perspective, do you find that sexism is inherent in the very heart of democracy? You know, this is very much my question. You know, that is to say, is sexism metaphysically implied in democracy? You know, where do you stand in this debate?
Well, hopefully not. Historically, women have been excluded from all forms of democracy. Yes. In fact, democracy has been a male creation historically. And because, in fact, at least in as far as we know, you know, of society that have called themselves democratic, who have particularly used this principle of governance and government, because on the other hand, there are many populations in which this model does not apply. For example, the native population of America, and the famous example of the Iroquois, you know, they had very egalitarian relation. In fact, women had a lot of power within the Iroquois society. And it turns out that, again, among indigenous, Native American indigenous population, this, so that the idea that is a kind of universal, right, that the subordination of women and the patriarchal power are a sort of universal, it's not valid. And there's been a growing documentation by anthropologists to show that this is not the case, right? At the same time, it is true, certainly, that patriarchy is not an invention of capitalism. Absolutely. The question is, why capitalism, that has transformed so many, revolutionized, and Marx says capitalism revolutionizes everything, right, has not revolutionized gender relation? Or better, capitalism has transformed gender relation, but has reconstituted new forms of patriarchy. So to me, the question is, right, the question has not been that capitalism has invented patriarchy, but why has found it necessary to maintain patriarchal relation, and what are the new forms of patriarchy? Because patriarchy is not always the same, takes very different form. I think that today we are witnessing the end of one type of patriarchy and the beginning of another type of patriarchy. For example, today, the model of femininity that was very popular when I was a child, you know, the self-sacrificial mother, that's not valued any longer. Certainly is not valued in many industrialized countries. Now, unless you have a job, now you have a certain amount of independence, you are nothing. Right, so there is a new, at the same time, the independence that women are gaining, who have gained the independence from men, not from capital, but the independence that women are gaining is an independence that is gained at the price of becoming like men. Right? In other words, for instance, we haven't been able to change the organization of work and the organization of conditions in the wage workplace. We don't even have childcare in most jobs, you know, which was something that the women's movement thought, oh, you know, in the future there will be all childcare. Nothing. Actually, we have less childcare today than we had in the 1780s, eighties. Right? In the United States, we don't even have maternity leave, right, which is really a scandal. So there is a type of patriarchy that basically says, hide as much as possible the fact that you are a woman. Nevertheless, don't lose your femininity completely, right? So now women have to work this very delicate dance, this very delicate balance between working like men, but nevertheless maintaining enough femininity so they do not threaten men, and at the same time they continue to do an immense amount of reproductive work. And so the model, we have a transformational model of patriarchy as well. A transformation in the model of patriarchy. Yes. Yes.
And I'm glad that you actually touched it upon, because I think it's a very taboo topic here in Croatia and women's movement, which I'm concerned with. And I think that the dominant position is the Swedish model, yeah, the criminalization of a client. And it's even difficult, I think, in certain occasions, in certain circles, to express a different opinion, because you are not to be labeled as supporting a patriarchal practice that is exploitative of all women and objectifies women, etc. And so this is, I think, and then the problem is, though, that we don't really, I didn't see it. I am a researcher, a legal researcher, and I don't see any research with the women who are engaged with the sex work. We don't know what they want. We don't know who they are. And yet we kind of assume what they feel. The legal situation is terrible. They are the ones who are subjected to misdemeanor proceedings. So the clients only in certain situations, if it's an underage sex worker, etc. So we have this terrible situation nobody is talking about. And my personal opinion, I'm in your camp for both normative reasons, because I think, yeah, I think first it's an auto-homogeneous group, but yeah, I can assume that it, many of them, that it's not probably the choice that you would made in a different social situations than we would have today, if you had more choice or if you're more empowered. But I wouldn't take a choice, in this limited amount of choice, I wouldn't take a choice that is there. I would rather work to empower women to choose something else if they want to. And then also for practical reasons, because
if you have the strike, secure that people working there do have the conditions they choose and do have rights and safety. But I'm glad that this topic is open up, and I think we really need to discuss it more, and we definitely need to work to decriminalize, not to have women criminalized as we have now.
Yeah. Also, I want to say that quickly, you know, when we speak of sex worker, there are also different types. There's also a ranking within sex workers, right? And I think with globalization, for example, in Europe and in the US, we have seen a major change. And I've done some research about Europe. I've done some research what happened, for instance, in Italy. And, you know, very much the same transformation that you see with reproductive work in general, where you see, for example, that the Italian sex worker, the woman that maybe 50 years ago was in the street, now works in an apartment, has a limited amount of client, she may go by appointment, et cetera. She's a companion, for conferences. Whereas the woman who works the street is usually an immigrant woman, often actually coming from Eastern Europe or coming from Africa. And so that's very important to also keep that in mind. Also, it's important to keep that in mind that there's been a tremendous amount of organizing among sex workers. That this is very, very important, that in many cases has created sex workers' commons. For example, in different parts of the world, now sex workers work in cooperatives, rather than working or either in the street with a pimp and so on, but they work in women's cooperative, in a collective, so that they give each other support, and they protect themselves from violence, and also they have more power in terms of setting the conditions of the work. And by the way, for those of you who are not familiar, I think it's a very enlightening reading, is to learn about the kind of sex workers movement that developed in the 1970s and 80s throughout Europe and in the US, literally in the wake of the feminist movement, sparked off, for those of you who are my age, might remember, sparked off by a famous occupation in July 1975 in Lyon, the Church of Saint-Lizier. This occupation by sex workers was triggered by the fact that of a new city policy that forced them to go out of the city to prostitute, to go in areas where they would be more isolated and more exposed to violence. And in fact, a number of them were murdered. And after one more murder, you know, a whole 50 prostitutes actually occupy the church. And that was the beginning. That occupation became the center of a mobilization. A lot of women, feminists, went there, they held the church. And this created a movement. And within a few years, you actually had a sex workers movement who began to come out of the shadow. They began to come out of the shadow and begin to say, we are workers, you know, and we have want to fight for the same rights that other workers do. We are doing a service to society. Our work is not more disrespectable than other type of jobs. And it's only hypocritical, you know, to claim that this is precisely an objectification of women's life, etc. So I think it would be really interesting for those of you who don't remember this history or never had access to it to take a look at it.
Maybe I'll go a little bit back, but just a tiny, thank you very much for coming. Just a comment back on, yes, feminist movement in Croatia for maybe other some other also reasons was very suspicious since from the beginning of the 90s in the whole region, in the all former socialist bloc, one of the very first demands from the political elite was to legalize prostitution. Mm. And the fear was, since there was no movement, since there was no knowledge, I think this was the idea of opening just a new capitalist markets. This we felt as a threat, that this is one of the domain that men, new domain men wanted to control, since let's say people here in Croatia remember that a former union work, union representative of the workers' union was one who wanted to organize prostitutes. Yeah. The numbers we didn't know. And that very minute, the women who were losing job in the biggest Croatian workers' shops called Nama didn't have maybe the idea to organize them to oppose to the regime, to the new, you know, capitalist regime. This is also that always I'm very cautious when we speak. Where are the things in which, you know, a context are embedded? So for us, we immediately felt it as a threat, knowing what was going on the borders. And another thing I remember in the morning, you also talked about violence against women. So one really has to be very cautious. Mm-hmm. What happens? Does it matter of how women are organizing cooperatives? What happened when the door of the room are closed? Mm-hmm. And another thing, so I also would like to ask you a little bit to tell more about the violence against women. As in the morning you also said, women are exposed, they comprise over 50% of the inhabitants of the world, and daily they are exposed to violence. What type of paradigm shift we have to do that this has to stop?
Yeah, well, that's, yeah, first of all, it's very important that, in fact, most of the sex workers movement that I'm aware of are against legalization, because in fact legalization, which is different from rejecting criminalization, but legalization means to create a whole structure, in fact, of exploitation, the, you know, the famous brothels, etc. Now, in terms of, so I understand very much the opposition to that. The question of violence against women, I think there's been a tremendous surge, I think now statistically documented surge of cases of murder and cases of violence against women. This is now an international phenomenon, also very, very strong in Europe. I have a lot of, again, context with what is happening in Italy. The surge in the number of women who have been killed by people in their family, you know, their fiancé, their husband. In the United States, we have the same phenomenon. One of the main causes of miscarriage and death of the fetus has to do with the male violence, the violence of the father on the partners, you know, on women, which then causes them to miscarriage. So there are many, I think, that we really have again to connect, you know, this question to both the, of course, the sedimentation of much patriarchal ideology, but at the same time also this new development, you know, the crisis of the male wage has also meant the crisis of a certain power the men had over women, and coupled with the demand for women for autonomy, for independence, refusing subordination, is very much at the source of this phenomenon. So that what men could not obtain because of their diminished economic power, violence. And so in a way, this surge of violence really puts the spotlight on what has been the relationship between women and men. And we have also witnessed, in conjunction with that, the crisis of the family. The crisis of the male wage has been, in many cases, the crisis of the family. So now the number of women who live alone with their children has skyrocketed, you know, all over the world. You know, in Latin America now more and more, you know, the unit, the family unit, but in the United States too, is the sole supported mother, is the woman with the child. So this again, it's something that, you know, calls, you know, for the new feminist initiative. At the same time, I also want to stress the institutional violence and how that interacts and exasperates the form of personal violence. Because it's very important, in my view, and I'm not alone, you know, this all relaunching of war, militarism, right? The relaunch has also relaunched an aggressive form of masculinity, right? You know, now the soldier is again a kind of male model of masculinity, so that the proliferation of war and has been a very, very important contributor to this violence, right? In other words, we should not underestimate also the institutional violence that has increased against women. And I want to say something here, if we have time, I don't know. I mentioned about the question of, you know, institutional violence through war, but there's also another type of war that is taking place, you know, which is more invisible, is less prominent, but equally dangerous, and is taking place, you know, particularly under the guise of valorizing life. So it's very deceptive. You know, in the US now, there is really an attack on poor women and women of color, poor and of color, capacity to reproduce themselves, which is not any longer coded in the language of population control, but is coded in the language of the right to life. There is an attempt by right-wing organization to declare the fetus a person. And in the process of that, what has been happening and is beginning to come out, how much that has affected women's life, what has been happening is that women who are, you know, poor, low income, women of color, if they become pregnant, you know, as one recent study put it, they practically fall out of the boundaries of the Constitution, which means that if you're poor and you get pregnant, you are vulnerable to all kinds of accusation and all a whole set of practices, in your case, become are criminalized. For instance, women were in a car accident and were told the police, look, I'm pregnant, were arrested because they jeopardized, by being in the car and so on, they jeopardized the life of the fetus. Just the week before I left New York, this woman who was driving her two kids, she had just moved to a new place in Colorado, and in the snow, she was caught in a snowstorm, and she had an accident, her two children died, and she was accused now of murder her children because she had jeopardized their life. And there are now about a number of states who are drafting bills, a set of listing the type of behavior that can get you in trouble. So in the hospitals now, hospital for poor people, after you give birth, you're given a drug test. And if anything, if you test positive for any drug or to alcohol and so on, you can be arrested. So this is the kind of institutional violence that also, you know, it's growing. And again, it's presented in a very deceptive way as a sort of defense of life. But in reality, it's really a way of discouraging women who are poor to reproduce themselves.
Okay, I suggest that we collect the three questions and maybe you to give the final conclusion. Okay, Tomislav.
If you could comment the forms of reconfigurations of relations in reproductive work that are happening in the aftermath of austerity politics policies across Europe, at least, and it obviously puts pressure on wages, and in return it puts pressure on women work at home. So just your comment.
Should I speak? Yeah, okay. I don't really have a question, it's more of a comment, so I don't know if she should answer first and I comment, or... So my...
Comment.
Okay, my comment was just that I really think it's important, at least for me, that you stated that you were specifically really anti-capitalist, and I think for all of us it's really important to have an anti-capitalist perspective on any sort of analysis that we do of what's going on right now, and like historically contextual perspective, because specifically because of what you said of why capitalism is a system that has in fact perpetrated and recreated, for example, patriarchy, but not only patriarchy, also colonialism, sexism, and a bunch of other stuff that we could keep naming. So I think it's, I'm really glad that you said that, because I think that's a really important perspective to have whenever we talk about all these issues as whatever you know, radicals, leftists, whatever you want to call it. Because it's just, you know, it's a really important aspect of the world that we live in today. You know, if you talk about sex work, if you talk about, can you hear me? Okay. If you talk about sex work, you know, in your earlier panel discussion, you were talking about housework, you know, nannies, that in many places, not only in the United States, in Latin America, you know, I'm from Chile, a lot of these nannies come from Peru, from Bolivia. They're usually indigenous, from poor communities. And capitalism just keeps perpetuating all these dynamics. So I'm really glad that you said that. And also, I kept thinking about, you know, you talked about, you know, the role of reproduction and all of this. And something that I haven't heard in any of these discussions, but that I've heard in my own work with other people, is the case of, and I'm going to mispronounce this word, surrogacy.
Yes.
And how... Yeah. Surrogacy, and specifically international surrogacy, is really coming up, and it's created a really peculiar dynamic. You know, there are certain places where surrogacy is prohibited, and so people that obviously have the means because surrogacy is really expensive, have to outsource their own reproduction to, for example, India or other places.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
okay, just take Tony, small question, and the person from here.
Silvia, just wondering, I've heard this several times, whether your view on the state is more nuanced than what we hear. You always speak against the state, but you just acknowledged that in 70s or 80s, there were certain things that workers' movements won, and you acknowledge tonight that you're seeing the role now of the Communist Party in the past, what it did for workers' communities. So I just wonder, do you see historically, if you take at least the last 70 or 80 years, there were certain things that state introduced as practices and institutional aspects that did actually place emphasis on reproduction in totality and help women?
Okay, can I respond to this thing? Because I'm afraid to forget, and then I will respond to...
Yes, maybe.
Just briefly, because the, I think, of course, right, what is happening now throughout Europe and obviously what is happening now in Greece, in Italy, in Spain, it's very much a continuation of the practices that we have seen in the 80s, as you know, was said last night, in the practices in the 80s. And this, of course, puts a tremendous stress particularly on women, who are, again, have been asked to compensate for the cuts in services, the collapse in income, et cetera, et cetera. I guess I want to the main point I want to make in relation to your question is that what is the lesson, if we look at the last 30 years, what is the lesson that we learn? I think we learn that you cannot keep silence when half of the world population is being impoverished as it was in the 1980s and not expect that it's going, that you are going to be spared that impoverishment. That in fact, the fact that you know, you had this massive attack on the people's capacity to reproduce themselves, you know, land expropriation, deforestation, you know, under the name of structural adjustment, entire community had to sell their forests, etc. Throughout Africa, Latin America, then we have the attack on Eastern Europe. Well, now, in the United States, there is a slogan, the chicken have come home to roost, you know, the chicken have come home to roost. Now it's happening in Greece and so on, and who's next tomorrow? The moment in which a good part of the world, at the same time, because of that, you know, because of that extreme austerity and structural austerity that has been imposed, it's also, you know, encouraging, forcing people to create, invent forms of reproduction, you know, that are outside of the state and outside of the market to, you know, this for example, I don't know if people here are familiar with the work of this Uruguayan writer, Raul Zibeki, who has written some very, very beautiful books. He's not alone, but his books are very powerful on the kind of communities of resistance that have been created mostly by women throughout Latin America, you know, Chile, Peru, Argentina, you know, that have been sparked off by austerity, by the austerity measure. They were sparked off by the need to survive, you know, at the time when there was no money, no employment, and therefore, women began to collectivize their reproduction, right? They began to start cooking together, the famous common kitchens, you know, 70 women who cooked together in a neighborhood. In fact, all over Chile, after the Pinochet coup, women began to cook together to the point that the women who cooked together, cooking together, began to be persecuted as a form of communism, right? Cooking together became because they was realized that the cooking together was a form of resistance. And the cooking together also brought people together at a time when assembling was forbidden. And it represented not only a way that people had to feed themselves and to stretch their money, but it represented also a way of breaking the isolation, circulating information that women could do because they were less suspicious than men, because they went with the children. And in that way, they began whole networks, these networks of resistance. So something like that, I think, could be also an inspiration for us. Like this, I think, are examples that are very powerful to realize that, in a way, you know, what is happening in a, you know, capitalism now, it's more and more of showing its face, that they have created a system where they can continuously expropriate us just by moving money at the speed of life, moving capital from country to country. They can actually demobilize, deindustrialize, pauperize, you know, overnight the entire population, as it happened with the Asian crisis and so forth, right? So the need actually to begin to reclaim our life and organize outside of the state. Nevertheless, the question of the state, right? As I said before, we cannot say, okay, we create our commons on our own and let's forget the state. But the state has our wealth. That's the reality. You know, the public is really private in many ways because the state controls it. We are at the point in the US that we have to fight for the right to sit on a pavement. You know, in certain towns of the US, in Los Angeles, they will fight for the ability to stay in the pavement because you have to pay for the right. You know, as you know, across the world, they struggle now about vending in the street, right? From India to Lagos and so on, you know. Because the state realizes that vending, the kind of cooperation that you find in many Latin America, African cities, those street markets now are seen as a danger. Because they are places where people learn to cooperate. They are places where people build a relationship of trust, where people learn each other, support each other. And this way, so they use all kinds of, you know, excuses. Oh, it's not hygienic. Oh, it's an ugly sight to see all these people sitting. But actually, that street marketing, you know, we are now beginning to realize that it constitutes a power and has been one of the missions of the neoliberal program that many governments have embraced to destroy them, right? So, About the question of the state, for a long time, myself and others also have looked at the welfare state as a kind of victory, a working class victory, you know? But yeah, so you the New Deal in the United States, the New Deal, it was the end of the Depression and the welfare. We are now beginning to have a more critical eye. Right? We're beginning to have a more critical eye because we are beginning to realize that before the welfare state, we didn't have a vacuum. There was something before the welfare state, you know, before the 1930s, and I'm here speaking just about the US. What you had, it was self-organization. It was working class self-organization. The unions of the time were also the organization you went to when you had a work accident. When somebody in the family died, the working class family died, and you needed a funeral, the union helped you pay the funeral. Pension, you turned to the union. In other words, you had unions who were not negotiating and fighting only on the so-called workplace, but actually were embedded in the community. They were embedded in every aspect of community life. And so there was a very important difference because when you had a strike, everybody mobilized. You know, there was no separation between the union, the workplace, and the community, right? And so, and with the welfare state, of course, you the advantage of reliability, of course, now you have the guaranteed certain rights, but at the same time, you also begin to have a separation where the union become a kind of disempowered, bureaucratic, and certainly separated from the working class community. And the community itself, right, it become isolated from the so-called workplace, in fact. So we are now beginning to see that with the crisis, the precarization of wage labor, unpaid labor is never precarized, but with the precarization of wage labor and the dismantling of many working class and industrial outfits, we're beginning to see that the community is becoming the neighborhood, the territory, because the work community has lots of problems, is becoming again a place of resistance, which it was, for instance, in the United States for the Black Power movement, for the civil rights movement. Their base was the community, was not, right? And we are beginning to see that the crisis of the workplace, the wage workplace, right, is such that now most strike can only succeed if the community participates. You know, one classic example was a recent strike of teachers in Chicago. You know, that was very, very difficult strike, you know, because it was not just for more money. It was really challenging a whole perverse practice that is coming down, which is you as a teacher are paid as much, or you can be fired if your students are not performing well. So you're responsible directly for the performance of your students, and then you can actually be fired if your students are not passing certain tests, regardless of the conditions of living of your students, you know, who many times come from very poor communities, their parents are in jail, et cetera, et cetera. So the strike was difficult, but they won because, you know, the whole community supported them. So in that sense, you know, we are rethinking the question of the welfare state in a different way, which doesn't mean that at the same time we are not fighting to, you know, defend pension, to defend healthcare, but we want to go beyond that. We want to go beyond that defense. We want to create structures in the community that also connects with people who are working inside, so we can actually give power to each other, and we can actually create the base to think, to first of all regain control over the healthcare process, as one example, or education, and also re-question what is healthcare, what is education, because it's also clear that the kind of educational healthcare that the state has provided is very functional, obviously, and today more and more. Today, healthcare and education are nightmares because they are totally commercialized, completely commercialized. The marketization is extreme. So that's the... there was any other question?
I think...
Of this and that question. And the,
do yeah. you have the energy for more?
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, I don't have problem, no.
Okay. No. Ne sanja, ne sonja ti. Okay.
it's not a question, really. I have just a few to suggest about this sex workers topic. I think it's in this case similar, it's an analogy to 40s and post-40s working. Sex work is very limited in time and very limited in only on the sex topic. But it is not very much difference to this contract work, which is called family, which is called marriage, which is called partnership treaty.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's taking a longer time. Usually it's embedded in more fields of care work. But this is a only difference in my view. And I attend very much to this. And I'm quite certain that there are not much more betrayal and violence in the sex workers' sphere than in families.
Well, actually, the 90% of the crime against women today are committed by people they know. Yes, thank you for.
Okay.
Thank you.
I would like to thank Silvia Federici for the lecture and for the discussion. And and the audience, and many thanks to the translators. Thank you.